I'm Anthony Tamburi. I'm the Dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute, and welcome you all, and I'm delighted for this event. This is an event that has had various manifestations through the planning of it. It is a preview, in some ways, of what we hope to be a larger event in the next 6 to 8 months. Why Calabria? Calabria is sort of part of a discussion that we began, I think, back in February of 2011, when we were asked to present a book entitled Terruni, in Italian, by Pino Aprile. And when we were asked to do that, I didn't think we would get a crowd. I said to the person who had contacted me that if Pino Aprile is happy with five people in the audience, we're more than happy to do it. I was more than pleasantly surprised. I was ecstatic at the fact that we had not only double figures, but actually 50 people. So in the last 10 years or so, Calabria has started to be a blip on the radar screen, and of course the last 5 or 6 years even more. A little bit of that, I think, is we can say Terruni had some part because people started talking about the South in general. And people started talking about regions. And the South was no longer just Naples and Sicily, but it was actually other regions, Puglia and then Calabria. And of course, we know that Calabria has also gotten a bad name, as Sicily had only a bad name about 40 years ago. Now Sicily has also a good name because everybody wants to go to the mare in Sicily, because they have such beautiful, right? Well, Calabria also has beautiful mare and beautiful seaside places. But still, we seem to know it only for that one big negative aspect. And as unique as it may be, it's not the one thing you want to be really known for, right? To have the most vicious and the most sort of insidious organized crime element. And there's a lot of culture in Calabria that for some reason or another hasn't, at least in the United States, hasn't hit mainstream. And so that was sort of part of the reason why we wanted to do this. We have a relationship with the University of Calabria. Fred Gardefee and I went there 2 falls ago to do a week each on Italian American literature and cinema. And then last year we organized a course in which a number of us, myself, Fred, Sam Patti, who's here, Paolo Giordano, who's not here, and who else was the other? Peter Carravetta, there he is. And so we did a course last year that's much more substantial course. And with that, I wanna compliment, Margherita's heard me say this 4 and 5 and 6 ad nauseam, actually, but I wanna compliment the University of Calabria because the University of Calabria was the first university in Italy to institutionalize a course dedicated to Italian American studies, not only, but it is actually a required course that's part of the course of study for modern and contemporary Italian literature. And so that thought of connecting Italian literature and Italian American culture is unique. And with that, we have to say to the University of Calabria, to Margherita, to the president Crisci, and so forth, con tanto di cappello, because they've done things that no other university wanted to do, and now all of a sudden people are knocking on our door. So, brava. So what we're going to do is the first section will be, we have 3 people. We have Joseph Luzzi, who's the author of My Two Italies. Copies of the book are available for $20. We have Mark Rotella, who's the author of Stolen Figs. Unfortunately, we don't have copies available. We were hoping that the press would have some. And then we have Peter Caravetta is going to read, talk to us a little bit about Calabrian poetry, and then he's going to read some poetry and also read some of his own, as he is, among other things, a poet in his own right. And so with that, I want to call up first Joseph Luzzi, who is, among other things, the author of My Two Italies. He teaches Italian at Bard College, where he's an associate professor, and he's also the author of some libri scientifici, as we say in Italian, on both 19th century Italian literature and also modern and contemporary Italian cinema. Prego.
Thanks so much, Anthony. This feels like a homecoming because it's I have so much respect and admiration for what Anthony's done with the Calandra Institute. It's become a true showcase for living Italian American culture and showing us the potential of in ways in which we can create relations between the Italian culture in the United States and the Italian culture in Italy. And writing my book has brought me more in contact with some of the things that are happening here at Calandra, and I think it's very exciting. And so it's a thrill in that regard to be here. It's also homecoming because in a way, my career didn't start out writing the kind of book that I ended up writing, My Two Italies, which brought me back to Calabria, which brought me back to my childhood, brought me back to the land of my parents, and really helped me understand my own relationship to Italian studies and the work that I do as a teacher and a scholar. Anthony calls them libri scientifici. I call them books with footnotes. So this has notes, but they're not footnotes in the traditional, here the notes are very discreet. So what I'd like to do is, I apologize in advance, I have to leave about 11:15, 11:20 because of a family obligation, but I'm going to read for about 15 minutes or so and then turn it over to Mark and Peter and look forward to your questions afterwards. So I'll just read a couple brief passages from the book and just talk a little bit about them. You know, the book became something very different than it was started out to be. When I first started out to write the book, it was supposed to be a kind of, this was in the full thrall of Berlusconi's resignation in 2011, November 2011, I believe it was, the last resignation. And Italy was in the press quite a bit. And so I wanted to write a book that kind of talked about the problems that Italy was facing in a kind of Berlusconian and post-Berlusconian society, combining my sense of life in contemporary Italy, but also my work as a scholar that had worked on Italian culture going back centuries. So I thought I would talk about things, Italy's political tensions today, draw on the North-South divide, the language question, all these things that even someone like Dante wrote about in the 1300s. And yet when I started to write the book, I was kind of stymied because it didn't have a narrative center. It didn't have that kind of lifeblood. It had some ideas and facts, but it didn't have a story. And so one day I was sort of struggling with the book in the third floor of the Bard Library in total silence. And I don't know if I dozed off or if I was daydreaming or what, but I started to just think about my childhood. And I remembered the smell from my childhood. And then I sort of like stopped trying to write about, there is a chapter actually about Italy in after Berlusconi. I stopped trying to do that political historical analysis and I just started channeling these memories. And I'll read you the little passage because in a way it's where the book was born. Some days I would come home from school. Okay, here we are, okay. But even in my first fitful steps towards Italy, I felt pulled by something more instinctual than academic clout or career calling. I wanted access to my family's history. Yes, they had abandoned Italy for good, but a part of them remained fixed in that blasted Calabrian landscape. Their broken English, canned tomatoes and slaughtered pigs, homemade wine and cured meats, it all reeked of the old country. And then I wrote, some days I would come home from school and burst into the house for an afternoon snack, hoping for a buttered slab of my mom's freshly baked bread, only to have my hunger stifled by the odor wafting from a downstairs pot. These were the days my mother boiled cow stomach, the blanched organ, tripe, that revealed just how different, less refined, less American we were from our neighbors with their vacuum Pontiac Bonnevilles and pine-scented air fresheners. So that smell of tripe, which goes into your soul, I mean, I know that now it's a favorite of foodies, right? Tripe is hot, tripe is chic. But when I was growing up, it was just this powerful, she was cooking in these industrial-sized vats, and it was this incredible smell, and I just sort of, Proust talks about the Madeleine releasing memories. for me, it was the tripe. And I just, at that point, I just stopped trying to write the book. And I just started remembering the stories. And my first readers were saying, I don't feel like you're writing. I feel like you're just, you're letting the story tell itself. And then that's when the family narratives took over. And then I realized that this was the book that I had to write, because in a way, I could get at the history, culture of Italy, but it had to come through a story, a personal story. It had to be anchored in something real and concrete. Because what's extraordinary about, I learned in writing this book, is that my family's history, personal history with a small h, collided with capital history with an H, whether it be World War II, whether it be immigration, whether it be assimilation, whether it be the American dream, all these big concepts that we think about and study as scholars, intellectuals, and thinking people, it all played itself out in my family's history. Just to give you one example, Dante in the 1300s wrote about, in the De Vulgare Eloquentia, on eloquence of the vernacular, Italy's lack of a common Italian language. And that, you know, a Sicilian would have difficulty communicating with a Tuscan, with a Milanese, etc. And Italy, Italian, of course, didn't really exist as a language. It became, the Italian language became the Tuscan dialect after unification was chosen as Italy's language. So the language question is such a big part of Italian history. My family lived it out. My dad didn't speak Italian. He immigrated to the United States when he was 36, didn't speak standard Italian. His Calabrian was frozen in time because he had left Calabria at 36, and he didn't speak English. So this was a man without a standard language, right? He could swear. I mean, he could swear like crazy. And you know, I wrote a little piece about that. And part of the book is about the curses, you know, these King Lear-like curses where he would say, "Ti vo sciupare la faccia un cane, may a dog rip your face off." Or, "Ti vo pigliare una scupettata, may you be shot." And I used to joke about these. Actually, I was mortified when I was a kid, because I was the brunt of these jokes. But I realized that was his living connection to Italy. You know, my dad never got over leaving Italy, I realized. He passed away in 95. There was a sense of the language was a repository of his memories. And he lost the Calabrian landscape, all these things that formed his identity. And this became clear to me in writing the book. And so I wanted to write the book for two reasons. One, I wanted a record of what that generation, how they lived, what they did, the words they said before it disappeared. Because when that generation, the generation of my parents, dies, the memories will die with them. You know, their ability to can vegetables, raise animals, this incredible craft that they brought with them to the new world, their language. I certainly can't do it. You know, their grandchildren don't speak Calabrian. Once they go, it goes with them. So I wanted to preserve it on paper for good. The other thing is, I realized something writing the book, and that's, you know, we don't think of our parents as people. We don't think of our, we think of them in their relationship to us. And we also think of immigration as an upward narrative, right? Very poor in southern Italy, come to the United States, boom, middle class. Son goes to great schools, gets a great education, etc. An upward narrative, which is true to a certain extent. But what I realized writing the book is that there's also a loss that comes with that. That as poor as my family was in Calabria, and they were very poor, it was their life. You know, it was their home country, their family, their friends, and they left that. So in a way, I came to see that my parents were exiles in addition to immigrants, especially my father, who never assimilated to the United States. And, you know, I study Dante, and Dante has this wonderful image in Paradiso 17 where his exile is predicted. And the Italian is something like, his ancestor says to him, come sa di sale, something like that. You will come to know how salty is the bread of another's table. And anyone who's been to Florence knows that they don't make their bread with salt, right? And they haven't since the Middle Ages. So is that a literal metaphor of this undigestible meal that exile would bring? And I do think in a way, you know, that was my parents, especially my father's experience. And it made me really, it gave me a sense of awe of the immigrant experience, of people who would make that sacrifice for their children. And it also made me think that this is a book about Italy, but it's really about the American family, because so many families in the United States have this story of emigration, the trauma of a separation from homeland, and the recreation of an identity that comes with a loss and a sacrifice of an ethnic heritage. So that's that became my, you know, affective, emotional reason for writing the book. On a kind of scholarly, intellectual basis, what I wanted to do is fill a slot that I felt hadn't been filled. I felt that there was a kind of schizophrenia in, as someone who was a professor of Italian, between Italian and Italian-American studies, in that on the one hand, I felt there was this kind of love for Italy, this, we could call it the Tuscan sun phenomenon, right? Go to Italy, restore a villa, embrace a high-carb diet, fall in love. And then on the other hand, you have so many of the negative stereotypes, right? The Godfather, the Jersey Shore, the Sopranos. And why was there this distance, this gulf? And so I wanted to show how Italian culture and Italian-American culture, the two worlds that made me, one personally and one professionally, can actually be connected. And just to give you, I talked about Dante and the language question. Another example is this wonderful book by Alessandro Manzoni, The Betrothed. The great Italian novel, right, from the 19th century. It hasn't translated well, it hasn't traveled well. He's not read so much outside of Italy. But Manzoni wrote his book in 1827, basically in Lombard, with a mix of other Italian dialects put in. He was Milanese, he spoke French as much as he did Italian. And when he published his book in 1827 to universal acclaim in Italy, he actually stopped and rewrote the book. And it took him almost 20 years. And he translated it into Tuscan with the help of a Florentine governess, Emilia Luti. And what an amazing act. What a sort of self-abnegating act. You know, once you finish the book, the last thing you want to do is go back to it, especially translate it. And he did that because he knew Italy lacked a common language, and he had to write it in this completely artificial unifying language, Tuscan, that became, he bet very correctly, the official language of Italy. So now I have about 5 minutes. I will read one last little passage to give you a taste of the book. And I can give you a taste by showing the transition that my book went into. At first, I had an epigraph by the great Petrarch, right? The Italy's finest, arguably finest lyric poet. And it wasn't working with the book, the kind of book I want to write. And then I did a little research online, and I found a Calabrian proverb that fit much better. And so we got rid of Petrarch and brought in the Calabrian. So I'll read you the proverb and then the first couple pages of the book. Si volessi sapere i segreti era a casa, domanda i creaturi. If you want to know the secrets of a family, ask the children. So I'll read the very beginning, okay? You killed him, you killed him. Giuseppe, aspetta, my mother called as I fled the kitchen in tears, accusing her and my father of murder on the holiest Catholic day of the year. Easter Sunday had started with such promise. That morning, the house had been filled with the smell of frittata, a sausage, egg, and cheese casserole that left rose-colored oil slicks on your plate. I mopped them up with upano di Pasqua, the Calabrian Easter bread made from 2 hard-boiled eggs that was baked into a figure-eight-shaped dough flavored with anise. As the flavors were blending inside, I had awaited the arrival of my favorite relative, Kumara Amendina. The mere mention of my godmother's name could halt card games between my father and his expat circle. She had earned the most glorious title any Calabrian woman could hope for, Fimanella, little woman. She who cooks, cleans, bears children, nurses grudges, would sooner self-flagellate than commit adultery, and doesn't put on too much weight with the passing of years, as opposed to the non-femminelle, huge women who roamed Little Italy like mastodons in black dresses. The gift of beauty didn't end with Amandina. She had three girls, and the youngest, Giuliana, had that other honor reserved for the Calabrian female elite. She looked German. My people revered these few fair-haired creatures with blue eyes and light skin. Amandina arrived, and with a living, breathing present, my very own Easter rabbit. All during childhood, I burned with envy as I watched other children care for their pet cats, hamsters, even parrots and lizards. Though our yard teemed with winged and hoofed animals of all kinds, our home was off limits to the non-human. I case sono per gente, e animali per mangiare. Houses are for people and animals are for eating, my parents would say. Anything with four legs was banished from the house, especially dogs, the animals I yearned for more than any other. I often saw my parents carrying a decapitated chicken or a bucket filled with crows shot from the downstairs window. Pasquale and Yolanda Luzzi were hardly the ideal stewards for man's best friend. The one dog we had, Sam, was kept in an escape-proof doghouse sealed with wire mesh. Sam was no fool. He ran away a few months after arriving. Maybe he saw my father wailing away on our poor goat, as was his habit, and realized he would be much better off with a real American family. I took the rabbit in my arms. Circumstances had kept me from becoming an animal person. But this guy, with his white fur and gentle eyes, a present from my favorite relative to boot, was different, just like Kumara Amandina. I would cherish him, I swore to myself. I'd make sure that the creature enjoyed a different fate from Sam's. My mother and father smiled, Amandina gushed, and the bunny went back in his box. That afternoon, I imagined that the rabbit was resting while I played outside. In truth, he was about to face an ordeal that would have shocked even battle-scarred Sam. Apparently, my mother and father weren't just admiring the rabbit's dreamy eyes. They were sizing up his haunches. I don't know what it took, my mother's usual two brisk whacks with a stick to the back of the skull, or my father's preferred twist of the neck in his thick fingers. But by 5 p.m., my pet had become an entree. I came into the kitchen to find him splayed out, his glycerin blue eyes lifeless and coated in oil, over a bed of roasted potatoes. It took my mom an hour to calm me as she explained that she and my father hadn't tricked me. They had planned it all along and just assumed that I knew what was coming. She spoke with a smile. That was the worst of it. To her, destroying my pet was no different from weeding the garden. I followed my mother to the kitchen table, slunk back into my abandoned seat, and, tears spilling onto my napkin, ate my pet rabbit. Thank you very much.
Our second speaker is Mark Rotella. He's going to talk from his book, Stolen Figs, but he has another book everybody should read, Amore, and it's about Italian-American song, basically from the whole 20th century and all the crooners. So, Mark?
I'm always thrilled to speak at the Calandra Institute. I feel Anthony has always been very supportive of my books and getting me to speak here and getting word out of the books. And I'm just really thrilled that an organization like this, that this academic institution exists. And Joe Shora was very helpful in directing me to various points of research for this book, For Amore. At a time when I found that there was very little to be found about Calabria, even being Italian-American, I felt because, as we've always, we've been saying, so all of us are from different regions and we're very connected to our family, then region, but not very much Italian to Italy itself. I mean, or at least to as a unified Italy. And I grew up in Florida, which at the time when I grew up in St. Petersburg, it was very south. I grew up away from my grandparents who lived in Connecticut. My father and mother had moved to Atlanta when I was three and then to St. Petersburg. So I grew up during basically, which was kind of incredible how it lasted that long, desegregation south. So I was, throughout my whole time in Florida, I was the darkest person I knew. I was the only one who had a vowel at the end of my name. I was geeky, I was kind of awkward, but nonetheless, I was given the name the Italian Stallion. Right when Rocky came out, I was really thrilled about that. But it wasn't until I was bused to mostly black schools, and met so many friends, and I still was known as an Italian there, and I'm only half Italian. My mother, who's Quebecois, French Canadian, reminds me all the time, no matter how much I've done writing on Italian, she says, "You're only half Italian." And my book came about, my father was sculpting. He would go to Italy once a month, mostly in Perugia, to sculpt. He would go out to Carrara, get marble, bring it back to a studio in Perugia, and sculpt. And at one time, he said, after I graduated college, he said, "Why don't you come with me?" And I said, "All right." Stayed with him for a month. We were in Perugia. And I had been curious about his hometown, about Calabria. And at one point, I started doing I couldn't find anything on Calabria other than Norman Douglas and George Gissing. And there was just nothing. And I went to all the libraries. And so I decided to start taking notes myself. And I was really excited about going down. I had been talking to my father. I said, "Let's go." You know, I said, "You know, when we go there, I want to make a trip to Calabria." He said, "What do you want to do that for?" I said, "Well, I want to see where the family's from." He goes, "They're all dead or they moved to Torino. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I haven't been back there." He spent, although he was born here just a couple of weeks after his mother arrived. It was an arranged marriage. And then he went back to Italy for a little while. So he had known his cousins, his aunts and uncles, and they remembered him. And but he hadn't been in touch with them since he was maybe 15 or 13. And I remember at one point we're in Perugia, and he had just come from his studio. I was out in the countryside with a couple of Italian friends who I met, and we would go to the same gelateria in the middle of town. We'd come from the studio. He was all covered in dust. He was wearing work clothes, and we had ordered. He had ordered in his Calabrese dialect, and each time the man behind just kind of slopped the gelato on a cone and gave it to him, just not even saying anything to him. And it, and to me, it was a little more gentle and precise. My father would order in Calabrese, or what I realized was Calabrese. I didn't realize that he didn't speak Italian until we got to Perugia, that I realized that he only spoke Calabrese, he spoke the dialect. And one time it was a strong rainstorm and we stayed inside. We usually take the ice cream out. And we started speaking, and the proprietor came to us. He goes, "Wait, you're American. You speak English." And he said, "Yes." He goes, "Oh, I thought you were from South." He goes, "Well, my family's from there." He's like, "No, you're not from the South. You're American." And at this point, we started getting this attention when he realized that my father wasn't a worker from Calabria. At one point after that, I think he was really interested in going back down, and I had convinced him and worked on him. And I said, "Pops, I'm taking the train down tomorrow." And we went out, had dinner, bottle of wine. He goes, "I'm going to go with you." So we went down. We took a trip down. And, I mean, it took hours to get from Perugia to Rome to Naples to Lamezia and then the train down southwest to Catanzaro Lido. And then from there, we took a cogwheel train up to the village. And even then, we had about 200 steps to get right to the top of the village from the train station. We got up to the top, thirsty, it was hot, end of July, I guess. And we walked into a store, ordered a bottle of water. The gentleman, his name was Giuseppe, recognized my father's dialect and said, "Oh, you're from here." They said, "How do you know?" He goes, "Well, your dialect is Gimignanese." And he said, "How do you know?" He said, "Well, this is what we speak here." And he said, "Who's your relatives?" And he said, what's your name? Rotella. He goes, no, what's your mother's name? Critelli. He goes, "You know, the women keep in touch." So he said, oh, I know Critelli. I dated an Angelina. By my gosh. In high school, you know, we're going to find your relatives. So he took us all around. He drove us down. Within 5 minutes, it was just like a little down the alleyway, little narrow alleyway. He knocked on the door, and he said, a woman came out. He goes, Angelina, he goes, you've got relatives from America. And she looked at my father. He looked at her. They recognized each other, and she put her hands on her hips. Fra 30 anni non scrive niente. And he said, and he says, and you haven't written me either. She goes, so we go in, and there was, Joseph was saying, the woman in black dress, the mastodons of Italy, which I love that. And she said, just two nights ago, I had a dream that we were getting a gift from America, and there we were, and everyone starts kind of tearing up. There was a rabbit ragu on the stove, which rabbits were. Reading his book, I love the commonalities. I realize how so many of us have similar situations. The rabbit. She brought us up to her room. Up to the living room, and she just called out from the back balcony to relatives that we had relatives from America. And within 15 minutes, the living room was filled with relatives with Gimignanese, and it was amazing to me that there all these people who I was blood related to, or related to, and my father remembered his cousins, his aunts and uncles, they were second cousins to me. I had no idea we had this much family in Italy. And at one point, she looked at me and she said, my cousin Angelina, my great aunt, she said, how's your sister? I said, how do you know I have a sister? And she goes, well, of course. And she reaches on the bookshelf behind her. I had a nice bookshelf with books, lots of books, and a photo album. And she was opening it up. And there were photos of my sister and me from when we were born until our first year of college, which I realized was when my grandmother died. And this whole time, she had been sending photos of us to Calabria, to the relatives. She had been making donations to the church. In fact, my father, we didn't quite know how much. She had been sending money to the church, and he had asked, he had gone to the church, the local, in Gimignano, in Superiore. And he had said, you know, I'd like to make a donation in the memory of my mother. I don't know if you remember her. And he said, and the priest said, we would love to, but your mother has been treating us very well over the years. So I had been a writer. I had been writing fiction, and my agent said, I had come back from this trip, and she said, put the fiction aside. This is your book. And this is when I started doing the research on the book. And I had gone back a couple times with my wife, and then one time for about a couple months. We'd go for about a month at a time. And this became an exploration of whether I was, you know, being Italian, Italian-American, and Calabrese. And I'm just going to read a section here that, as I was there, I started feeling, I had days where I felt very Italian. I felt days I felt very Italian-American. And there's some days I felt Calabrese. I remembered the smells from my grandmother's kitchen, as Joseph said. I remember my father was always very proud to be Calabrese. I mean, he would let me know whenever there was someone from Calabria. He knew it. I didn't even know, it didn't register with me what Calabria was until I was there. And we would go to local, there were two Italian places in Tampa, St. Petersburg. Fonte's was one that served. We would go there for our meats. And cheeses and pasta, and that was the one thing we had. And I remember friends coming over to our house and thinking, "What are these people eating?" We were the only people who ate this. I mean, it was again growing up in the South, it was quite a difference. But they would come over all the time to eat what my mother ended up having, you know, cooking, because she ended up cooking Italian food to please my father. But then there were also times when I just really felt not Italian American. So I was traveling, I was walking around the village with Massino, who worked for the Comune, and he was getting people to register to vote. They're having votes, and he wanted to make sure that everyone was registered. And he was met with mostly, I'll vote if I get a chance to. And he's like, well, you know, you kind of have to. And he gave me a little tour of the village for a few days. And we happened to stop, and this kind of was a bit of a defining moment for me in certain ways. On the way to Sabrina's house, Sabrina's my cousin, Massino and I stopped off at the village's bocce court. Bocce, developed in ancient Rome, is a cross between horseshoes and shuffleboard and is played throughout Italy. So basically, when I was there, I had never played, because I didn't grow up in a big Italian-American community. I didn't have bocce. I didn't have a lot of the things that many people, and I was envious of, what I thought many Italian-Americans had. The big family, your what I, you know, what one would think is the stereotypical big family with all this tradition. I didn't have that. The bocce court in Gimignano stands above the main road that connects Inferiore with Superiore. A single court surrounded by a chain link fence. You enter through a wood hut that serves as a clubhouse where an older man and young boy were just preparing to play. Each had his own bocce set in a hard case, the balls shiny, silver, and carved with circles and spirals in various patterns. Marco, this is another Rotella. Filippo, Massino said. That's my grandfather's name, Filippo Rotella, I said as I introduced myself to the older man. He examined me and said nothing. He offered his huge hand. Maybe you two are relatives, Massino said. Do you play bocce? Filippo asked. I've never played, I answered. He looked at me skeptically and placed a ball in my hand. It was heavier than it had appeared. We'll form teams, Massino said. You and Filippo, me and the kid. But I've never played before, I protested. Massino walked over to the club hut and dug into a cooler. He pulled out three bottles of Czech beer and gave one to each of the adults. Massino tossed the small rubber ball, the pallino, that serves as a marker. The goal of the game is to get your bocce ball closest to the pallino. I was the first to bowl. I had watched the game a couple of times and thought the trick was to toss it with my palm down, giving it a spin backward so it wouldn't fall too far. The ball hit where I had intended, but with too much force, and it rolled out of bounds. Ah, Filippo cried. What was that? I tried again. This time the ball fell shorter and rolled to a point that I would have considered quite close to the pallino. No, 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 Filippo said. Massimo took a turn, each ball getting closer to the pallino. Then Filippo went. He bowled and struck out Pallino's ball, allowing his to land a few inches closer. The boy bowled and his ball landed just a scratch closer yet. Aim here, Filippo said, pointing with his foot. I tried again. The boy looked on quietly, but Massimo hooted me on. Come on, Rotella, come on! I noticed that the other three bowled underhanded, so I decided to try it that way. This time my ball came closer than Filippo's, but not as close as the boy's. I thought it was my best bowl yet. No, Filippo raged. You're changing your style. Overhanded, underhanded, overhanded. Which one is it? Decide. I knew the Italians were passionate about bocce. Arguing and yelling were a major part of the game. But I couldn't believe that Filippo, knowing this was my first time playing, wouldn't take it easy on me. All right, I went back to my original style of pitching, but my nerves were shattered. My bowl went wild, and this time even Massino responded with a pitiful bowl. Drink another beer, Filippo said. It might help your game. And that was the last thing he said to me for the rest of the game. As we put away our balls, Massino came up to me and patted me on the back. Okay, bocce's not your game, but tomorrow we'll go see Catanzaro play football. You'll be able to watch. I extended my hand to Filippo, thanking him for allowing me to play. He put out a limp hand, shrugged, and said, I don't think we're related. So, and that was at times when I just really didn't understand quite what the difference was to being a true Calabrese, and it was something as simple as bocce. But what I liked most about the trip, it was interesting, I had when I read Joseph's book, we were the same about no animals in the house. We had one cat that, and his name was Sammy, similar to your dog's name. And my father would keep him outside. If it got very cold, he could come into the laundry room, but only the laundry room. And he said, just give the cat lettuce or whatever. We don't need to feed him stuff. They'll eat. If he's hungry, they'll eat. That cat loved my father, would follow him all over the yard. As my father was planting and digging, he would help. He would get in there and help. But it was interesting. My father had just kind of an adversarial reaction to Sammy. But it was very similar. Even my father, was second generation, had that same feeling, like, nope, no animals in the house. But through, I think one thing that I am really happy about now is that through Facebook, I haven't gone back to Italy or to Calabria. I've been back to Italy, but not to Calabria in quite some time. But through Facebook, I've been still in touch with so many of my relatives, my aunts and uncles, cousins. And we've seen through Facebook our own kids grow up. I've seen them age. They've seen me age. And it's been really great. So I communicate with them, and that gap has started to close now through that. So, and I think that is, I would love to go back again. I don't know if you've gone back recently, just to see what it was like. But for me, I still feel Calabrese, I think because of my father, and going back. So I think that's it. So thank you all.
Our third speaker is Peter Caravetta, who is also an author of, as I said before, Libri Scientifici, among other books. And his also have footnotes, long footnotes. And he's also a poet in his own right. Today he's going to talk to us about poetry with Calabrian roots and read some poems both by others as well as himself.
Well, thank you very much, Anthony, and thank you, everyone, for being here. I don't know what I'm doing here. I guess I owe you the 5 1-minute biography. I was born in Calabria, in the province of Cosenza. I came to this country when I was 12, so my Calabresità was kind of stunted, so to speak. And I consider my adolescent years in the Bronx more important. But then chance had it that I went back to Italy to study for a master's degree, and then I visited my native town 3 or 4 times, and each time I had a totally different feeling. Now, at that time, I was a young poet, so I had to write about my emotions, what I felt each time I went back to the little town with population, il comune 1500, the town is 500 people. I mean, you really have to work on Google Earth to go in, and then eventually you see La Pano, because, you know, even Google Earth has a problem finding it. I had very, very complicated relationship with my native town, with Calabria in general, and only later, thanks to philosophy and history, I've acquired a kind of distance that, and thanks to people like Margherita Ganeri and others in the last several years, I started sort of rediscovering it and loving it, actually, much more now than I ever did. So I'm going to, a few things. I did write a couple of poems in dialect. I would like you to hear one. But I should tell you that Calabria in general, I mean, I'm not an expert on its literature, but it has a long-standing tradition that goes back to the before Greece became Greece, there was Sibari, you know, and there were other schools in Calabria, you know, of poetry and philosophy already from the 6th century BC. You also know that just like a lot of other regions in the south of Italy, has been invaded and occupied something like 30 different times. When I was younger, I used to try to argue that, well, you know, they weren't really, did not touch the real Calabresità, you know, you want to be proud. But then later I learned that there were so many invasions and so on that I decided to adopt the rule, which is like derived from genetics, that the more you mix, the better it is for the human species. So I think the Calabrians are very close to perfect because they blend about 30 different ethnic groups, you know. Everybody went through Calabria and Sicily as well, you know, but they are like on the island, we're on the continent, and so we count a little bit more than the Sicilians. Well, hopefully there's no Sicilians out here. With a little that I know about the traditions are, of course, that there's before the saga of emigration, of which there's a rich literature in the last 200 years, 150 years, one of the traits of the poetry in Calabria has been that of really complaining about these people that used to dominate incredible taxes and basically mistreat the population. And so there's a lot about surviving oppressors and surviving hard nature. These seem to be themes that run throughout the tradition. There's also a tradition of a satirical tradition, you know, which is really, really good, and it's what some people actually resort to when, like, there's no hope. I just want to read you, just to give you an example, from three poets from the early 20th century who actually extremely learned, because all of a sudden you find, for instance, the story of Ugale, who is the simpleton of the Provincia di Cosenza, is a kind of like a fool, a Shakespearean fool, every town is a fool, ucciuto to do paese, si dice, you know? And, of course, in the hands of a master, the story of Ugale by Antonio Chiappetta becomes like kind of like an epic. It's written in ottava rima, and it actually begins with a kind of a classical what am I looking for? Okay, with the first stanza is an invocation. Musa, compagna mia, se ti la vienti vieni a parlare di un uomo fatato, l'unume suo l'hanno portato le vienti a ogni terra e paese abitato, lo sa figline trenta e li feruci e agli squazzati se spasa la voce. These are towns nearby where the poet is writing, but it gives it this kind of thing, like as if he's talking like, you know, Virgil, you know, and he went from the Phoenicians to Naples to Gibraltar. It's like these faraway places. And then in the second stanza says, Addimannate Achille da Prigliano, puramente Achille Petrafitta, Addimannate stuomene soprano, chi sapia fare due crubbi a napitta. Now, this is a classical first idea that it's going into the fun part. E chi n'era Ugale vuoi intentiti, già una cosa certo la sapiti. When you say of somebody che sa fare due crubbi a napitta, means like he's a simpleton. Cioè, you don't get any more stupid than that. But this is one thing that's about 30 years or so I want to translate, but I never get to it. Another one is Prampuglie, Mariano Salerno, who had the nickname Uvatalaro. Uvatalaro is a guy who just talks nonstop. And he also wrote some beautiful little poems. I just read a couple of lines because it's slightly different. I don't know if you can tell. This is the Partenza dei Prigionieri. E sim all'ultimo atto, mo partimo, compagni, amici, presto ne lassamo. L'ultima sigaretta ne spartimo, poi ne abbracciamo e per lo mondo iamo. And so on. I mean, there's a lot about traveling, there's about suffering, I mean, a lot about just putting up with life, which was very hard in those days, especially since after unification we didn't get the railroad, you know. To Cosenza, they voted to have along the coast, and so a lot of the hinterland, the inner part of Calabria, has been like left out of the major economic boom until the 70s, until recently, really. I always like to when it, those times that I happen to use my own life as a kind of a historical compass. When I came in 1963, there were still people from Lapano, Rovito, the whole Calabria that were still emigrating. In fact, I am consider myself part of the big migration, the one from 1880 to about 1965, 67, 68. In 1969, while I was between college, high school and college, I worked in a pizza shop near my house. And I never forget, my father one day walks over, was two blocks away, and he brings somebody from, I said, who's this guy? And he goes, Ucanushi. All right, he said, chi sei Pierino? Ah, I was 12, I had never been back to Lapano yet. This is 69, what are we talking about, 6-7 years? And he was the brother of one of the teachers in the local schools. So this guy now was not emigrating. He was coming a visitare I parenti. So it was like, to me, it was like the first tourist from Lapano came see me, the old immigrant, you know, and we talked about and so on and so forth. Finally, another tradition, which is typical in the South, I think, is that of you know, the kind of, well, jestful, but also the kind of poetry that suggests, like, we have to really get by, so let's look at, like, let's have fun, let's look at how things could be funny or ridiculous. So there's another guy named Ciardullo, which begins with the underline, state tranquillo, non ci pensare, which is usually a way of saying you have problems, so don't think about it. And this begins this way. Se Lucciuccio scontricato vide a dir tu puditria, un c'è stare incannaccato, chiacchieria. Se la catte zia Vicenza va scamando per la via, che fa avuto d'astinenza, chiacchieria. Se la sorta spaturnata che t'ha messo alla sciania, vena e dice che è canciata, chiacchieria. Non è canciata. Okay, so, I mean, this, you know, it would take a trained voice to show the differences, but these are all from the area nearby where I was. There is also a poetry of protest in Calabria, and some of it found way, not just in what we would call, like, you know, declaiming that, you know, the signore or il whatever, you know, the local duke or archiduke or viceroy was cruel. There was also a lot of poetry against the church itself, against the abuses of the Vescovi, etc. In fact, in the 1700s, finally, when the Spanish Habsburg came back, there was a kind of a little bit of a reform already to take the power away from this feudal system. And one and some of the best poets from those years were very smart, enlightened, knowledgeable people who had become priests themselves, like Don Lupanto. And then they sort of manifest their protest in this kind of parody, violent parody, of, and sometimes just they use all kinds of sexual language, sexual actions. In fact, Don Lupanto's poetry, if I were to read it to you, it would make even the Marquis de Sade blush. Those levels. And it's all written by a priest who couldn't take any more the abuses of the church, and he writes his violent sexual political poems. One is called La Cunneide, and one is called La Cazzeide, so you get an idea. how much time do I have? I just want to read one poem. One or two poems, and that's it. One of them I'll read it directly in dialect, and if you want, I'll read it to you in English. I wrote this the third time that I went to Lapano from Bologna. Each time it was a different frame. But this time I was a little bit like angry at them. So I say, De chiro chi pariti e meglio ne parramo. Amo fatto due vie, due vite, due munni. C'è su cose cun se dicono e un ne capiscissimo de niente. Arrasso sia sapissi di caio fatto se meriche meriche, minne mannassi di estigne, e me cum mene cum aio fatto ogni volta chi minne viegno ririre, cuzzettiare, e può vedere chi re così c'è de sane che c'è pigliati giusto quando è cundo. Come se non ci fossi intra de vue, mienz una neglia pare che me vicio, a due guardo, si cuozze ierto, si vaggiuni pennino, a rispuntuni a due se io cava, e solo non ricordo, davvero, mi pare moni ciù come un suono. E poi mi dicete, ma perché non ci stai, ma ricogliate, che è la casa tua, cacca mo se sta de pace eterno. Ma che ci signe mi sento cubue, che non avrei mai dire chi se può chiedere, io camaro padruno, consamo che carro, mangiamo sotto la cerza, fissiamo un prievite. Sapete che mi ne vaio, fra un pare i giorni, sapete che non ci staio più di casa, un conto. Ed è così che mi tocca campare, come un forestiero che vena e si ne vani, una volta che ti ne si giuto, che si fuiuto o tinnare un mannato, non puoi dire più chi t'appartena. E poi veramente capisci perché ti ne vai notte giorno si pizzi pizzi, se dice come un remita, nu pazzo, nu spirito. And that was the third time around, I was like really feeling it. Okay, I'll stop right here. Thank you. Okay, I'll read you the English. By popular demand. Yeah, they're the same one. Because I think it's when I publish my book on migration, I'm going to put it on the front. Okay. I appreciate that you appreciate it. Okay. Here's how it sounds in English. And it took me 30 years to translate, and I'm not happy because you cannot translate yourself. Or what you seem to me, it is better not to say. We have traveled two roads, two lives, two worlds. There are things none supposed to tell, and we couldn't share much of it at all. Heaven forbid you learn of some tricky, troubling, all sinful things I've done roaming through that there faraway country. Why, you'd whip up a storm of condemnations, or burn me at the stake even. So it behooves me to do what I've always had to do at each of my returns. Smile vacantly and nod and mask the disbelief while telling you those typical weird stories about America you love so much to hear. I feel as if I weren't amongst you. I feel as if I were swirling in a fog. Wherever I lend my gaze or get a blinding spectrum of lives bygone, or the rugged Sierra or down the old ravine, or spot the alley corners by the church where you and I used to play to fill the afternoons. It is now only a speckled memory, really. It now feels more and more like an ancient tale or someone's life-sustaining dream. Then you say, but why don't you stay? Come back to this, your real home. Life is like heaven here in Calabria. But that I'm back now after 10 years, and actually this is the third time around, that I want to feel like one of the old bunch, that I should hear, let's go see the relative, or play soccer, or fix their old cart, or even make fun of the priest. Remember, chase a stray dog down to Santa Maria. You know I have to leave. You're too busy suddenly and too modern. You know I don't belong. Think of it, I no longer matter. And so this is how now I've got to live. Like a visitor alert to form and changed customs, like a Dantian shade haunted by what could have been. Once you have gone away, that you fled by choice or were forced to flee, you no longer know where you belong. And thus you roam by night and day from place to place endlessly. People have called you a hermit, a lunatic, a ghost. Thank you.
This is for Joseph. Did you become vegan after that?
No, it just made me more of a convicted carnivore. As I said, I had to admit, I ate the rabbit, I was crying. But it was delicious, and that was the irony of it, you know. It's kind of tragic comic. It was very traumatic when I was a kid, because like most kids, you just want to fit in. And I remember going to the lunchroom, and my mom would make these pepper and egg sandwiches, and I'd open it up, and the grease would come out, and all the kids would look at me, and I just wanted a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Now, of course, the pepper and egg tastes much better. But it was like one of these things that it took a long time to kind of understand the incredible, you know, home economics, right? In the Renaissance sense of the word, you know, running the home, which is a branch of literature in the Renaissance, like Alberti wrote Libro della Famiglia, that my family had an incredible home economics. And one of the chapters is called Blood Pudding, about when they used to slaughter the pigs.
Oh, right.
And, you know, my dad, he did it different ways. Sometimes a knife to the throat, once a hammer to the skull 4 times. I can still hear it ringing after all these years. And that was appalling to me. I thought they were barbaric. But, you know, now it's free range. Now it would be called humane slaughtering. And they used every inch of that pig, including the blood, which they made a pudding out of. And that's things that you, when you're young, you don't realize the kind of, as a friend of mine said, il genio della famiglia italiana. Now, he meant it in spirit, but I also love that word genio, as in genius, right? That's sort of the brilliance of these people. My dad was very extremely intelligent, no education at all, but they had this incredible capacity for craft and animal, you know, shaping the land and killing rabbits.
Bob.
I just wanted to, that's really not a question, I just wanted to say to Mark, I just totally loved the ending of that story. We're not related. I mean, it gives the lie to so much of the hokum that surrounds this whole subject. You know, it's a very difficult relationship that we have with Italians, actually. They want to love us, we want to love them, but we actually often don't like each other very much because we don't understand each other. It isn't only because they slaughter animals. They don't always do that anyway. But I mean, there are so many things that never, ever get said. You know, I had a long, tormented relationship with Paolo Valesio. We don't talk to each other very much anymore. We both got tired of it. Because whenever we would talk, he would always come back to the fact that the Americans had bombed Bologna when he was a little boy. And how did I expect him to ever get over that when he was talking to me or listening to me? Because it was just too much. And I mean, I tried to talk him out of it, but really, how could I? You know. Anyway, I just loved that. I thought that was great.
Oh, thank you. Thanks so much.
I'm going to be quiet about that.
Prego.
Hi, my name is Marcella, and I loved all your talks, but I couldn't help by, you know, making some comparisons. And so I was really struck by the fact that for Joe and Mark, it seemed like that, you know, your experience has been really marked by a rediscovery of your roots, and there is almost like a sense of pride or regained pride in doing that. I just wanted to know if my perception is accurate, whereas with Peter, there seemed to be still a more conflictual, you know, relationship, like kind of an ongoing, you know, struggle, right, with your roots. So could you all three talk a little bit about how much is this a tension, a conflict, or something that you have just embraced and, you know, overcome? I know it's a really personal issue to some extent, but I would love if you could expand a little bit on that.
I'm sure we can all answer in about 500 pages. Each. Well, Dina, you want to go first? I see you haven't talked much.
Yes. I became aware of it. I became proud of it. And I think the story that I just talked about when they said that about the bocce that were not related, I was actually pretty crestfallen because I wanted so much to be a part of that. And I realized that I was an outsider. And even relatives who had come to live here for as briefly as a year, they would go back to Calabria and they would always be known as L'American. Even though they came here, almost as if there was a taint on him or her, they would go back and almost as if they'd seen the other world and it was something different about that person. I couldn't believe, I think we're the Italians, maybe the Calabresi, were so different from maybe other immigrant groups, especially immigrant groups now. I felt the Irish would keep much better in touch with their relatives back in the old country, where there was this line once we came here. It was like, you're American now, and that was it. And I think my father and his brothers and sisters looked at their parents as kind of like, oh, they're such in the old world. My father was their interpreter for all of them. My grandmother never spoke English, so we spoke in dialect to each other. And what I was touched by was how my father became proud of being not just Italian, but Calabrese. And I think through, by making him go there, by him seeing how much work I've done on the book, and by researching, it made him proud. And I think, and yes, I am, but my father all of a sudden became in touch with his, with his Italianness, and talks to me about it all the time. And he'll start telling me stories he had never told me before. And I remember, and I wrote about this too, about, and just going back to the similarities in our immigrant, or parents' immigrant experience, my father's first time, it was, he was, I think, 12 or 11 years old, a little bit older than my son now. And his father decided that it was his time, he's come of age, to kill his first rabbit, which my grandfather raised. He had one breeding rabbit who he called Bucky. And he had other, so they raised rabbits, and my father always saw him grab by the ears, and my grandfather did it with one chop to the back and the neck, snap. So my father said, all right, well, let me do that, let me try it. And he did it, and the rabbit was squealing and squealing, and he dropped the rabbit, and my grandfather just looked on, pipe in hand, just watching to see what my father would do. Picked him up again, did it again. The rabbit was squealing, and my grandfather just watched. And then finally, my father saw a spade around the garage, picked it up, and started whacking the rabbit, because that's what he, to become a man in this, he had to kill the rabbit. And finally, he did it, and that was his lesson. But so he started telling me these stories that he didn't tell me before, but they brought it out. And I'm sorry, this is probably a longer answer to your question, but yes. Sorry.
If I can just pick up on that, I think that's a very perceptive comment that you make, because there is a kind of spectrum. I would say, though, when Peter spoke, I definitely, Mark and I have so much of a similar kind of background, but Peter's talk really resonated with me in that, in a way, my family, my parents were born in Italy, and my brothers and sisters were. So when I was born, I was the first American child, it was a Calabrian house. We weren't Italian-American. I never felt Italian-American. And having written this book, I think of Italian-Americans as really people who came from the classical period of emigration, right? The late 1800s, early 1900s. There was never a prohibition against speaking Italian in our house. We didn't have a lot of the racism and stereotypes that early immigrants did. And Italian-American culture, such that it's become iconically in the United States, just wasn't a part of our world. So I felt, in a way, I couldn't be proud of Calabrian culture because it was too close to me. I experienced it as a struggle between becoming American and not Italian, not Calabrian, not sure what it was, but it was something that I had to sort of define myself against. So I kept my distance from my 30 first cousins on my father's side. You know, a lot of the cultural things they did, and I sort of raced to become what I considered American. It's very different. Peter's struggle was the visceral sense of actually Calabria. Mine was more against this Calabrian outpost in the United States, which it's really in writing the book that I've sort of reconciled, you know. That's why I'm so grateful for the book, to kind of give me a sense of, I used the word homecoming when I sat up to give my talk. The book was a kind of homecoming because it allowed me to kind of reconcile what I had experienced growing up as a tension and a struggle, which is good. And I always, people say, what do you want? Yeah, I have a 7-year-old daughter. What do I want her to get from the book? I want her to get a sense of what her grandparents, the struggles they had to do, and that sense of resourcefulness and brilliance in making a life in a new country is something that, to me, is priceless. So. It may seem like pride, and it is, but it came at the end of a struggle.
Can I say just a couple of things? I think I'll try to be inspired by Joseph and Mark this morning, because I've been trying to write my memoir since 1974.
Wow.
That makes it 41 years. And I'm not joking. I have lots of files and various, you know, episodes and notes throughout my journals. Lucky that once in a while I managed to get something in a poem. No, I think my struggle is a little bit different for one, maybe a fundamental reason, and that is that
when I went back to for my master's in Bologna, actually I didn't even want to go to Bologna. It's one of those things that happens when you're young. You know, somebody gives you a scholarship and they say, why don't you, you know, I'll give you a scholarship if you learn Chinese. He goes, fine, I'll take it. So, you know, I ended up in Bologna, and I was fascinated with the language at that point because I had to relearn it. At home we spoke, I mean, I have the education of a sixth grader, fatta la prima media. Now, even if I was a bright boy, it's still 11 years old. So basically, when I went back to study in Bologna, I was 23, I really had to work hard, and I fell in love with the language. And that's what you pay for falling in love, you know, right? Because then I started writing in Italian, so I wrote all my life in two languages. And so when it comes to writing about my childhood, I have always faced this big existential metaphysical issue. In what language would I write it? So I've been trying to convince myself that I can do it in English, because I've built enough distance between me and the past that now I can, you know, tell the story like I'm telling to a friend. And I can do that in English. But if you sometimes, if you want to capture, like Fred said, if you want to capture, like, you know, something like strike a note, so much would have to be said in the dialect. And I refuse, ideologically, I refuse the dialect because it's of all the stigma and it's and all that stuff. That from 20 years, I didn't want to speak it anymore. For another period of 8 years, I never went to Calabria and so on. In the end, I realized it's another language. It's a third language. Why not? But it took me many, many years to come to grips with that. For the rest, even though you guys were born here, the thing about going taking lunch when I came here, the same story. But, you know, my great friend Bob, we're still friends after all these years, you know, he took me to his house and he says, you want to have some food? And I like the white bread, you know what I mean? And peanut butter. And I never liked peanut butter, but for the sake of being cool in junior high school, you know, I would tell him, I don't want the, you know, sandwich. I don't want to.
Great.
I just want to add one yep. thing. Just listening to you read the poems in the dialect, I just got chills. Yes. It was really, really powerful. Yeah. I wish I had a recording of it. I would just call up my father now and just play it to him, because when he went back to Calabria, he was almost this artifact coming from the United States that had been encapsulated. The way he spoke was in a dialect that no one there even speaks. And so they brought back, and all these kids were gathered around him to hear this dialect that was just stopped in the 1930s.
But that's true. This is actually my mother's dialect. Yeah. It's what I remember speaking in the when I was a child in the late 50s. And until my parents were alive, they would speak that with some variations mixed with Bronx, Neapolitan, etc. But even in my hometown, five, six years ago, I did a reading in my hometown, and anybody who was under 40 said, I never heard that word. I said, why don't you ask your mother or your father or your grandfather if they're still alive? I mean, the college-age students really understood only half of it because they're only Italianized. They're all, you know, most Italians, as we have heard from many linguists, you know, a lot of them have lost their dialect. You know, half of the population knows only Italian at this stage. So we're hearing me with this voice, with these words, you know, signor tropicato, una timba pennino. Because, Pieri, what are you saying?
I love it.